Hello, everybody, and welcome to Church Online Quarantine Hair Edition. We are so glad that you chose us here at North Rock today. My name's Kyle Gray, and I'm one of the pastors here. So I want to welcome you and say we are all here hanging out in the chat with you. Say hi, everybody. We're here to encourage you. We're here to pray for you. Overall, I hope you're as excited as we are to be here. I will tell you this, we've got an incredible service plan for you today, all right? It's really like our online stuff. People all over the world are being introduced to Jesus because we believe he meant when he said, when you gather two or more in my name, I'm gonna be there. That's why we're here. It would mean the world for us if you would just take 1 second and invite your friends, family, your loved ones, anybody you know to church online right now. It's never been easier. Invite them to church right now simply by sharing the link northrock.online.church. Where do I find it, Kyle? We are going to post it in the chat. All you have to do is copy and paste it. It's that easy. Holy cow, my hair. People around you guys need to hear about Jesus more now than any time that we've ever been a church. So let's invite them to church online today. You never know what God is going to do through you and I, no matter what we look like right now. Seriously, though, as we prepare our hearts together in worship, I want to prepare for Jesus to do what he's about to do in our hearts during prayer. So would you pray with me? God, thank you so much for your love. We're so thankful for your gratefulness, God, that you sent your son, Jesus, to us here, so that you could change us from the inside out. We love you, we lift you up, we dedicate this service to you in your name. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Come on, let's give him praise today.
There is a light that burns in the darkness. There is a hope washes the fear away. There is a peace that settles around us. It is your love that sets our hearts ablaze. Father, we're on our knees with every heartbeat we bring you this all.
There is a king.
There is a king who reigns in victory. There is a mercy strong enough to save. We feel it rising up from the ashes. It is your love that overcame the grave.
crucified in our hearts and in our lives today.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fail me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Yes, I know it's true. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you.
church.
Matchless in grace and mercy, there is nowhere we can hide from your love. You are steadfast, never failing, you are faithful. Our creation is in awe of who you are. You're the healer of the sick and the broken. You are comfort for every heart that moans. Our King and our Savior forever. And for eternity we will sing of all you've done. And for eternity we will sing of all you've done. And we sing, God, between us, God with us, and God for us, nothing can come against, no one can stand between us.
Courage, victory, strength, we find those in you, Jesus. Come on, church, sing it out.
In your heart, it moves with compassion. There is life, there is healing in your love. You're the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And for eternity we will sing of all you've done. We sing, God with us, God. can stand between us.
God with us, God for us, nothing can come against, no one can stand between us.
What an incredible reminder that we get when we sing that truth together. You know, I think back to times throughout this week that maybe I might have felt alone or maybe worry had gotten the best of me. But when I think of this powerful truth that applies in all times and seasons, it gives me hope that God is with us. God is for us, and nothing can separate us from that truth. Church, I love that we get to experience worship together like this. As we continue on today in an attitude of worship, we're getting ready to give. And this is a time that we continue our worship to God by affirming our trust in Him as the giver of every good thing in this life. We bring our gifts to God with glad and cheerful hearts, believing that He will not only bless our lives for being a giver, but even more importantly, that He will use these gifts to lead more people to the hope we have in Jesus. You know, your giving helped us reach over 1,400 people this past Easter with the message and the hope of Jesus, many of which said yes to Jesus for the first time. That all happens because people like you have been faithful to give a tithe and an offering here at North Rock. I hope you know that means the world to me, but more than that, I hope you know how much that means to Jesus. I just want to say thank you for opening your hearts to give. You can give today in two ways. First, by clicking the giving link in the chat or the comments section, or simply by texting the keyword NRGIVES to 77977. Again, that's NRGIVES to 77977. As we prepare to give today, what I love to do is I love for you to take that in your hand, whatever gift it is that you're giving today. And I want to pray over that gift, for that gift, and for you today. Will you pray with me? God, thank you for all the ways that you've provided for our lives. Today, we bring these gifts back to you with glad and cheerful hearts to say thank you and affirm your place as the provider and the giver of every good thing in our life. Lord, today we ask you to use these gifts to make an impact, to help more people find the hope that we have in Jesus. And God, as the pastor of these amazing people who so faithfully and so selflessly give, I pray every one of your promises over their lives today, promises of blessing, promises of prosperity and provision in their life in every way, in ways that maybe we even never dreamed possible. We thank you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Everybody, what's going on? Pastor Brian here. We're so glad that you came today. If you're new with us, let us know you're here today. It would mean the world to us. We want to answer any questions you might have about our church. Pray with you this week, or get you connected to the support you need. We'll post a link in the chat, or if you're on Facebook, in the comments section below the video. Thanks for taking a second to check in with us today. At North Rock Uversion, it's way more than an app. It's support, it's community, it's people who are willing to walk with you day in and day out through the ups and downs of life. It's people just like you, committed to growing deeper roots in their faith. So do yourself a favor right now and download that app. Download the Uversion Bible app today. Millions of people across the globe and hundreds in our community are in this app together daily, experiencing life. And we want you with us. So go ahead and download that app today. We're better together. I know you'll be glad you did.
Well, hello and welcome to everybody watching at Church Online. We are so glad that you are here today. My name is Jason Tucker, and I'm excited that you're here today because I believe today God wants to speak to our lives. God wants to encourage us amidst some storms in our lives, amidst some uncertainty in the world around us. We hope today that you engage in the time that we have together. Comment in the chat section or in the comment section. Let us know if we can be praying for you in any way. We have pastors online today that would love the opportunity to be praying for you and supporting you, encouraging you in any way that we can. 3 weeks ago, we started a series called How to Survive a Shipwreck. It's a series that has a lot of roots in the current situation that we find ourselves in the world today. Obviously, many of us are facing uncertainty in life, and that uncertainty at times can feel like our world is spinning out of control, like our boat is sinking on the seas of life. And what we've been talking about each week is how God wants to help us navigate the storms of life. Week one was on Easter Sunday. We said Jesus shipwrecked his own life, gave his life on the cross, died a gruesome death, but then was raised from the dead to show us how to survive a shipwreck. Last week, we said in the storms and the seasons of life where we experience storms, God wants to bring us peace. The message was called Impossible Peace. God wants to bring peace to the storms of your life and mine. Now, if you missed any message from this series, I want to encourage you to go back to our YouTube channel. You'll find all of the messages loaded in their entirety there. You can share them up, you can watch them, rewatch them again, whatever is best for you. We want to just encourage you during this series. And today, I'm excited because if I was going to give today's message a title, it would be this: Waves Were Made for Walking. Come on, somebody at home right now. Yes, you. Say that with me. Help me preach this message today. Waves were made for walking. Now, I don't know if you know this about me or not, but I'm an avid surfer. I've been an avid surfer my whole life. I got some pictures to prove it. This is me really getting after it under a monster wave, really, you know, just doing my thing, surfing the waves of the sea. Here's a little better picture so you can know that it's me and know that I'm not messing around. I'm really working that pipe. I'm surfing it hard. I mean, I know you never knew that about me and probably are super surprised and impressed, but I mean, surfing has been a big part of my life. And so obviously, I've had some people tell me that it looks like I might have superimposed my head on Chris Hemsworth's body, but I'm offended that you would even think that. Come on, do you not see the resemblance, right? Come on, in all seriousness, last week we talked about a story that relates to shipwrecks in life. And it was found in Matthew 8. And that story talked about one day when Jesus was hanging out with some of his friends. They were on the water together in a boat, and a storm blew up that threatened their safety. Jesus was sleeping in the back of the boat. And Jesus is obviously prepared for or ready for surfing, if you will, quote unquote, the vicious waves that were coming. But the disciples were not. They were not ready to surf or wave walk, if you will, the waves that they were experiencing. In fact, so much so that they woke Jesus up and said, "Don't you care that we're drowning? Don't you see what's happening? There's water coming into our boat. Our ship is sinking." And I think many of us are asking that question in our own lives. If we're honest, we're wondering, "God, where are you right now? You know, I lost my job last week, or maybe I'm facing some uncertainty in the future relative to my financial well-being or our house or whatever, you know, that you might be facing." Many of us are asking this question today, just like the disciples asked it then. Jesus, don't you care that we're drowning? Jesus wakes up from his sleep and hears this question, calms the storms. The Bible said he rebuked the storm and told it to lay down and be still, and it did. And the disciples were amazed at this. But then Jesus asked them a question. He said, "Why are you so afraid? Why are you so afraid?" Now, one of the things I believe that this dialogue between Jesus and the disciples was revealing was this big truth that all of us need to grab a hold of today. It's kind of the context for our discussion today, and that's this: humanity's deepest need becomes clear in our darkest storms. Our deepest need as human beings, it becomes clear right in the middle of our darkest storms. Jesus knew that day that the disciples were scared and fearful of loss and death. And he wanted to help them understand how to navigate those storms in life. And so obviously this sets up a beautiful context for what we're going to talk about today, because that was in Matthew chapter 8 that this discussion started. Now, if you fast forward just a few chapters in Matthew's gospel, what you find out is Jesus continues doing miraculous things. A lot of things that he's doing as he's living his life are astonishing. They're miraculous, obviously. And so those who are following him, his disciples, are watching this, are taking all of this in, and they're trying to make sense of it in their own lives. They're trying to learn what it means to them with relationship to Jesus. Now, in Matthew chapter 14, where we're going to pick up today, one of Jesus's, I mean, obviously Jesus called this man one of the greatest men to live, John the Baptist. John the Baptist had been taken captive, and the disciples told Jesus, "Hey, in chapter 14, John the Baptist is in trouble what are you going to do to help him? And Jesus said, John the Baptist, he'll be fine. He's good. It's going to be okay. Like, he'll be all right. Jesus proceeds out to go continue doing what he's doing, sharing the message of who he is with the people around him. Now, that's significant because the headlines, if you will, the newspaper headlines of chapter 14 of Matthew's gospel, they would have said this. The headlines would have said, John the Baptist gets beheaded. Say what? Jesus, I thought you said he was going to be okay. I thought you said things were going to be all right for John the Baptist. Jesus said, I did. I said they're going to be okay. Everything's going to be all right. John the Baptist is beheaded, and the disciples, they're shaken by this. But then immediately after this news comes to be, Jesus feeds 5,000 people on a mountainside one day while he's teaching. And it's one of the most famous stories in the Bible. He's out teaching throughout the day, the heat of the day. People are kind of getting tired and hungry. And he asks, do we have any food to feed these people with? And the disciples say, no, we don't have any food. And basically someone's Lunchable shows up, a Lunchable with some a few loaves of bread and two fish. And Jesus takes a Lunchable and he feeds 5,000, according to the Bible, men, and also, not counted in that number, their wives and children. Jesus feeds 5,000 with a Lunchable. Now, that's significant for a lot of reasons, because again, Jesus was telling people, I'm the bread of life. I am who I say I am, and I just need you to learn and understand that. And immediately following this news, he does something that I think is profound. He sends the disciples on a journey. Watch, we pick it up in Matthew 14. Immediately following that time, after he had just fed 5,000, this miraculous miracle had happened. Jesus made. He made the disciples get into a boat. He made them get into a boat. Maybe they had some fear of getting into a boat. Maybe the last time they got into a boat, they were like, we almost died. Like, Jesus made the disciples get into a boat and go ahead of him to the other side. Jesus said, you get in this boat, go ahead and head off to the other side. We're going to continue what we're doing there. I'll meet you there. But look what happened on the other side while he dismissed the crowd. Jesus said, I'm going to hang out with the crowd. You guys go ahead. So he sends them on this journey. Jesus made them get in the boat. I want to make a point of that so that you see this develop. The story continues. After sending them home, the people who he had fed that day, he went up into the hills. Another translation says he went up onto a mountaintop by himself to pray. Jesus went up on a mountaintop to spend time with God, and then night fell. So some time transpired from the moment that Jesus put the disciples in a boat and said, you go on ahead, sent them out in a boat, made them get in the boat and said, I'll meet you on the other side. And when night fell, so some time fell, night falls, while there he was alone on that mountainside, the disciples are out on the water. Now watch what happens. Meanwhile, while Jesus is up on this mountain, the disciples all of a sudden ended up in trouble again. Why? They were in trouble far away from land. They had sailed out far away from land, and a strong wind had risen. Here we go again, everybody. A strong wind had risen up, and they were fighting heavy waves. They were literally fighting these heavy waves and trying to keep the boat afloat. Again, water is coming over the side, and the uncertainty of sailing in crazy winds and waves, it has overcome them once again. And they think to themselves, I'm sure, here we go again. Version 2.0, right? The thing that this made me think of this week was my wife and I, we took a cruise a couple of years ago with a group of pastors. We were invited on a cruise. They said, hey, we want a bunch of pastors to go and spend some time together. And my wife and I had never been on a cruise. So we got on this ship, and obviously I was astonished by the size of the ship and everything else, but more astonished that as we left port, the size of the ocean, the expanse of the deep blue sea. But you know, when you're getting on a cruise ship, there's some excitement, right? You're like, hey, we're gonna have a good time. right? Woo-hoo-hoo. We're gonna have a great time. It's gonna be fun and it's gonna be exciting. Well, after we were on the boat for a very short time, the captain comes on and says, hey, before we get started with our festivities on the cruise, we need everybody to report to this one location because we need to talk to you about what happens if the ship goes down. And this was the look on my wife's face when they took us through the program, if you will, for that. It was a to-do. They explained to you how to use this flotation device. They explained what this little light beacon did. And obviously, you know, when you're sailing off, this was a picture of us leaving port with the cruise ships. You're sailing off into the deep blue. You're thinking, man, it's gorgeous. Like, it's blue and the waters are just fantastic. But when they're telling you that it's possible when you go far enough out on this thing, we don't know what could happen with the weather. We just want to prepare you. This is the look that is on your face. Like, well, what's happening? What are we doing? How's this going to turn out? Because obviously what they know and what you know, what I know, if you've sailed the seas of life enough, bright blue skies can turn very quickly into wind and waves that are treacherous for your life and for mine. You know, many of us right now, we're experiencing this in our lives. You're experiencing it at your job. You're experiencing it with your finances. You're experiencing it with your health and the world around you. You're experiencing it with the decisions of a government or a state that are telling you how to navigate these kind of storms in your life. And ironically enough, Jesus sent the disciples on this journey on purpose. Remember what I said earlier? He made them get in the boat. I think there's something for us to catch here today is that sometimes we're praying, Jesus, get me out of this. And Jesus is saying, I'm the one that got you into this. Let that sink in for a second. I know there's some tension related to those words, and we're going to resolve that tension today. Sometimes we're praying, Jesus, get me out of this situation. Get us out of this situation right now in the world with COVID-19 and all the uncertainty around it. Get us out of this situation financially, economically. Get us out of this situation in the stock market or the world around us or with my job. Get me out of this situation. And Jesus is saying, actually, I'm the one who wanted you to sail in it because I want to show you something. I want to help you understand how to navigate some things about the storms of life. And that's where the story continues. About 3:00 in the morning, so a significant amount of time had passed, in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus came towards them. So the disciples had been fighting the wind and the waves. Think about this. Since dinner time the night before, he fed 5,000, sent them out, and all night long, they fought the wind and the waves, trying to sail, thinking the boat was going to tip over, wondering if they were going to die, wondering where Jesus was. And Jesus, at 3:00 in the morning, notice this, after the fourth watch of the night, in other words, people were just, they were worn out. They were exhausted. They couldn't fight anymore. They had reached the end of the rope. They had to get some sleep. So they had to try to find somebody that could sleep in the middle of all these crazy storms, get some rest. And somebody had to keep watch on the boat and everything that was going on. Imagine this kind of a situation. I'm sure you can, because many of you are facing a situation very similar to this in your life. Jesus came towards them, though. Watch this. Walking on the water. Now, that's a peculiar thing if you consider the circumstance. Jesus wasn't in the boat with them like he was last time. He came to them this time walking on the water. Very important to understand this. Why? Why did Jesus do this? Why did he choose to show up this way? Why couldn't he have just shown up in the boat with them that day like he did before? Watch, I believe it's this. I believe God didn't promise us calm seas in life. He promised us wave walking on the wild seas of life. God didn't promise you and I calm seas. He didn't say, hey, everything's gonna be good in life. If you do this, follow this plan, everything will be good. Actually, Jesus said just the opposite. In John 16:33, he said, in this world, you will have trouble. You will experience crazy seas, but take heart. I have overcome the world. He didn't promise calm seas. He promised you and I the ability to walk on the waves, to navigate the waves of the seas of our lives, the seas of uncertainty. And that's where the story continues. When the disciples saw Jesus walking on the water, they freaked out. And you and I would do the same, right? That's unusual. You're in the middle of a storm. It's the middle of the night, 3 o'clock in the morning, and off in the distance, something comes walking on the water at you. I would have freaked out too. But watch, the disciples saw him walking on the water. They were terrified. And in their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost." In other words, no human being, nobody can do this. That's insane to imagine. It's gotta be something supernatural or paranormal, if you will. But Jesus spoke to them at once. As soon as he saw that, he spoke to them and said, "Do not be afraid." There those words are again. He said, "Take courage. I am here." Come on, somebody. Say those words with me today. I am here. What is significant about Jesus saying that? "No, I understand you're here, Jesus. I understand you're with me, but don't you see me drowning? Don't you see the water coming over the boat? Don't you see the uncertainty I'm facing in life? Don't you see that I lost my job? Don't you see that the economy is falling apart? The world is in shambles. Don't you see what's happening? And all you have to say is, I am here?" Absolutely, because he was trying to communicate something to the disciples that day. The same thing he's trying to communicate to you and I today, and that's this. He didn't show up with an answer. He showed up as the answer. He didn't show up with an answer. He showed up as the answer. Now, in the middle of storms and uncertainty, there are a lot of people that will show up to your life with an answer. Can I get a good amen, somebody? There are a lot of people that will show up and tell you, you should have saved more money. There are a lot of people that will tell you, you should have taken the job in healthcare because it was more stable, and you're seeing that in the world today. There are a lot of people that would have said, you should have went to college. There are a lot of people that said, you should have wrote your wife a love letter, and that's why you ended up in the situation that you're in. There are a lot of people that will show up to the storms of your life with an answer. Jesus did not show up with an answer. He showed up as the answer. He said, "I'm here. I am here." He didn't have any other instructions for them beyond that. And the story continues. Peter in the boat. Peter's the bold one. He's the one that flips tables over, right? he's the boisterous one, the outspoken one. I'm sure he's been up all the waking hours of the night trying to keep this boat afloat, trying to keep the disciples together and not tearing each other apart. Peter says, "Lord, if it's you that I'm seeing out on that water," Peter replied, "you tell me to come to you on the water. If you can walk on those waves, I'm seeing you do that powerfully. I want you to tell me to come out to you walking on that water." And Jesus said, "Come on, come on, let's go, come on." I'm sure everyone astonished again, 3 o'clock in the morning. Are we dreaming this? What is happening here? Look what happens. "Come on," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat. Peter went surfing, everybody. He went surfing without a surfboard. Peter walked on the water and he came towards Jesus. Peter starts walking on the water and he's coming towards Jesus. I mean, imagine that moment. For you and for I. It's that moment when we trust God, when we see there's uncertainty. God, are you ahead of me? Are you one step ahead of me, really? Okay, well, I'm gonna step out in faith. And when we do, we start walking on the water in front of us. We start wave walking because notice something. Nowhere in scripture does it say that when Peter got out of the boat, that the waves stopped. Nowhere in scripture does it say that when Peter decided to make that move and walk towards Jesus, that the wind calmed down. No, the wind was still blowing and the waves were still crashing against the boat. There was still uncertainty, but Peter took a step out of the boat. He said, "Jesus, if it's you, I'm gonna come towards you and that'll prove to me that you're here. Get me out of this boat. I don't wanna be in this boat anymore." He walked on the water as he came to Jesus. But watch what happened. But when he saw the strong wind and the waves, when he started walking on that ocean and feeling the uncertainty of the strong wind and waves, he was terrified. Fear gripped him again. Again, his greatest need, his deepest need revealed itself again, and he began to sink on those seas. And he cries out to God, "Save me, Lord," he shouted. "Save me, God, I am sinking." Listen, here's what we learn about the story, and here's what we learn about our own lives. Wave walking reveals the storms we're experiencing inside of us. Wave walking, it reveals the storms we're experiencing inside of us. Now remember, Jesus wanted to deal with the storms going on inside of the disciples. They were experiencing storms outside, but he wanted to deal with the storms on the inside. And when Peter saw the waves and he felt the pressure of the wind, he began to sink. And that revealed his heart towards who Jesus was. And if Jesus, that Jesus walking on the water in the middle of that storm that night, could help him. And the story continues. Jesus immediately, as soon as he hears Peter crying out, Peter begins to sink and then he cries out. As soon as he hears him cry out, he reaches down immediately and grabs him. And he says, "You have so little faith," Jesus said. "Why do you doubt me? You were doing so good. You were coming towards me. You were on your way in the right direction towards me." Again, this dialogue is all happening while waves are still crashing against the boat and wind is still blowing very violently around them. So Jesus and Peter, when they climbed back into the boat, when they got back in, they stopped saying, "Get me out of this." And they got back in the boat. When they got back in the boat, the wind stopped, just like that. Jesus didn't speak to it. He didn't have to speak to it. It just stopped. Then the disciples worshiped him. They realized in that moment who Jesus really was. Jesus is not an answer. He is the answer. Come on, somebody. The disciples realized in that moment, you are not an answer. You are the answer. You are the one that calms the winds and the waves in our lives. The revelation, it finally began to set in their hearts. I believe for all of us today, that's the journey God wants to take all of us on. But it's the storms and the waves and the winds around us that are keeping us all from that revelation, from that understanding. But we need to catch this today. We need to grab a hold of this. That sometimes God needs to calm the storm inside us before calming the storm around us. Sometimes, that day when Jesus made them get into the boat, his purpose, his intention was, he knew when they set sail how this would all turn out. He knew from the beginning. They were facing the uncertainty of all the headlines going on around them, but Jesus knew how this was going to turn out for them. Sometimes God needs to calm the storm inside of us before he can calm the storm around us. Paul explains this a little bit in his letters to the churches, particularly in this letter to the church in Corinth. He says it this way. Now, right now, we see things imperfectly. Like our view of things, how things work, it's imperfect right now, like puzzling reflections in a mirror. We don't see the whole picture like Jesus does. But then, in other words, then at that point, he's referring to when I see things perfectly in heaven, but as I'm on that journey, Jesus is helping me every day see more like this, see more clearly, then we will see everything with perfect clarity. That's why Jesus wanted them to go wave walking. That's why Jesus wanted them to experience him walking up to them on the seas of life, walking on the water. He wanted to help them see with perfect clarity who he was. Not an answer, the answer. All that I know now is partial. This is Paul. He says, all I know now, it really doesn't, It's only partial. I've only got half the story or a part of the story. It's incomplete. But then, as Jesus helps me again, you won't know everything this side of heaven, but you and I can both know a lot more if we dig into what God can help us with in this life. Then I will know everything completely. It'll make more sense to me. I'll be able to understand what's going on and what God is trying to accomplish through the situations and the storms in my life. Just as God now knows me completely, I'll know things more completely as Jesus reveals them to me. So I think for all of us, it really boils down to this. The question that we have to ask ourselves when we experience uncertainty in life, when your life falls apart right in front of you, when your boat sinks, you lose the job, you lose the relationship, maybe you lose the loved one, and you're going through this uncertainty in life, questioning, wondering, how can God be in the middle of this storm? The question we have to ask ourselves, or the thing we have to navigate, is this: how do we walk on the waves of life and not drown in them? How do we walk on the waves of life and not drown in them? We see a beautiful picture in this story. And I think something that we can carry with us practically this week. I love to give you practical teaching that you can leave today with and go literally put it into practice in your life. First thing is this. How do you do this? How do you walk on the waves instead of drown in them? First thing is this. You have to keep your eyes fixed on what God says, not what you see. I have to keep my eyes fixed on what God says, not what I see. Jonathan Martin, the author of the book, How to Survive a Shipwreck, that's the book that this series is based on. He said it this way. He said, you can't cling to the God you knew, the God you once knew, maybe the Sunday school version of Jesus, because, you know, that version of Jesus is not going to help you navigate the future storms that you're going to experience in your life. You can't cling to the God that you knew, or the God that your parents knew, or the God that your pastor knows, or the God that your friend knows. The only person, the only thing you can cling to when your life starts to crash and rattle around you is the only God you can cling to is the God you know now. The God that you know right now. Many of us, we feel distant from God. We're not spending time digging into God's word. That's why it's important. We say every week, you need to get in the YouVersion Bible app. It's 5 minutes a day that you can get to know God, the God of now, the God of right now, who can help you navigate the storms of your life. Not the God that you knew then, the God that you knew 10 years ago. No, God wants to develop that relationship. He's taking us on a journey. Remember what Paul said? Now what I know is impartial, but then God wants to help me right now, today, in this moment. He wants to help me navigate these next 24 hours in my life, no matter how crazy the storms are. Now, I don't think you'll ever see a better picture of this in action than in the Bible in Psalm 91, because Psalm 91 is really a declaration, if you will, that Israel as a nation, it was written by King David. It used to be something they would read and believe that when reading it, just reading it and reminding themselves of it, would realign their hearts with God and literally bring protection to the storms of their life. Watch this. I'll show it to you. It says, Psalm 91, 1-3, those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. When you decide you're going to live your life under the shelter of God, and that's going to be your plan. You don't have a plan B. You don't have an answer. You have the answer. When you live like this, David said, this I declare about the Lord. Here's what I've noticed about God when I live that way. He alone is my refuge. I don't need anything else. I need him, my place of safety. He's my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust him. For he will rescue you from every trap. God will rescue you when you make him the refuge in the storms of your life. When you call out the name of Jesus. When you realize you don't need the answers that the government can provide you. You don't need the answers of a stimulus check. You don't need the answers of these things that you're waiting on or looking to as answers to your current situation in life. No, actually what you need, you don't need an answer. You need the answer. I need the answer. And the answer is an answer I can trust. An answer that's going to lead me to safety, a refuge. It's my God. That's where I find it. And in that, I find a rescue from every trap. And look at this, protection from every deadly disease. That's powerful, church. Those are powerful, powerful words spoken. It goes on to say, if you say, the Lord is my refuge. If you say, I don't need any other answers. It's God and God alone. It's what God says, not what I see. If you say that, the Lord is my refuge, and you make the Most High your dwelling, you dwell with Jesus. You run with Jesus. You go on the journey to say, I know there are a lot of rabbit trails running around about how we're going to fix this and how this is going to get better, but I'm running with Jesus, everybody. I'm making him my dwelling. Look what the Bible says. No harm will overtake you. No harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you, and he will guard you in all of your ways. I've got to take my eyes off of what I can see. I got to take my concern off of what policy is coming to try to fix this or what we're going to do about this economy or this stock market or the world, that how it's going to be normal or not normal, a new normal after this. I've got to leave all of my focus off of those high winds and heavy waves, and I've got to dwell in the secret safety of the Most High. I've got to remember, I got to keep my eyes on what God says, not what I see. Really simply, the second part, I think if we do that first part, If we go on the journey to say, that's what I'm going to do, I'm going to do that, I'm going to trust God in that way, the second part is simply this. Notice the storm didn't stop when Peter got out of the boat. A lot of times we celebrate the faith of Peter because he was getting out of the boat. But can I give you a different twist on that today? A lot of times we're saying, God, get me out of this. But Jesus is saying, actually, I got you into this. I'm walking you through this. So for the storm to stop in your life, it's not about you getting out of the boat. You getting out of the boat is about you learning how to navigate and walk on the seas of life. But there's only one way that those storms stop. The storm stops in your life and in my life. We have to remember, the storm doesn't stop because I climbed out. The storm stopped because Jesus climbed in. Come on, somebody. The storm doesn't stop because I climb out. It's not because I decide I'm going to fix this. It's not because I decide it's time for me to take action or I got a good plan for how to tackle this or navigate this. The storm in your life and mine, it doesn't stop because we climb out. It stopped because Jesus climbed in. We opened our hearts to him. We opened our lives to him. We said, we need you in this boat with us. We stop praying, God, get me out of this. We start praying, God, I need you in the boat with me through this. The author of How to Survive a Shipwreck said it this way. He said, surviving the shipwreck in general in your life has much more to do with letting go than it does with holding on. Listen to those words, friends. Come on, today, God wants to help you today. He wants to bring freedom to your life today. He wants to liberate you amidst the storms that you're experiencing, to go wave walking, but to understand that when fear grips you, when the waves and the wind are too much for you to handle, and they will be too much for you to handle in life at times, it's not about you getting out of your boat. It's about Jesus getting in your boat. It's not about you holding on, continuing to paddle, figuring it out, coming up with a plan. It's about you saying, is Jesus in the boat with me? Is Jesus in this boat with me? It's much more about letting go than it is about holding on. Psalm 91, it concludes with this almost this dialogue between David and God. And God responds to David saying, I'm going to live in the shadow of the Most High. I'm going to believe what God says and not what I see. I'm going to put my trust not in my ability to solve my own problems, not in my ability to get out of my own boats, but in Jesus's ability to get into my boat. Watch what it says as the passage closes out, Psalm 91, 14 and 15. God says about us, about David, about you today, because he or she has focused their love. You focused your love on me, God says. You focused your love on me. It wasn't about you getting out and loving yourself and figuring out how to figure this out by yourself. No, you focused on me getting in your boat. You figured out, I will deliver you if you do that. I'll be with you. I will shut that storm down right now. I will protect you because he knows my name. That person, they know my name. They've let me into their boat. They've let me into their heart. When he calls out to me, I'll answer. When he says, save me, like Peter did, I'll immediately answer, just like Jesus did. I will be with him or her. I'll be with them in their distress. I will deliver them and I will honor them. Come on, this is what God wants for our lives, but we've got to catch this today, church, in the middle of our uncertainty. Jesus didn't show up with an answer. He showed up as the answer. And sometimes when you're navigating the storms of your life, the difficult seasons, and you're saying, God, get me out of this. God's saying, actually, I want to walk with you through this. Because before he can calm the storms around you today, his first priority is calming the storm inside of you. Come on, I know that's a lot to take in, and today, as we wrap up our service, I just invite you into a moment where you press away all the noise. And if just for a second, you really ponder those two truths. God, where have I been looking at the wind and the waves in my life? Where have I taken my eyes off of what you say is true? And we ask God to help us, to forgive us for that. But then on top of that, we say, God, I'm done striving to solve this storm, to fix this storm on my own. No, I'm gonna find my refuge, my strength, my safety in the shadow of a God that loves me. It's not about me getting out of my boat. It's about Jesus getting in my boat. Come on, as we wrap up today's service, right there where you're at, will you pray with me today? God, thank you so much. Thank you for scripture, that it's been preserved throughout time. And that in these stories and in the lives of these people, we can see you at work and we can see your fingerprint on their lives, but also on our lives, just the same. God, for every one of us, please today, I'm asking you to help us with the noise of the wind and the waves. Some of us, the boat has already gone down and we're floating on the open ocean with nothing more than a life preserver. Many of us are feeling that uncertainty in our lives today. But God, I ask today that you would help our hearts to believe, to trust you, to know that it's not about getting out of this. It's about what you're walking us through and what you're teaching us in the middle of this. So give us the courage today to fix our eyes and focus on what you say, not what we see. Give us the courage this week to dig into a Bible, to get in that YouVersion plan and discover the God of now, not the God that we knew then. We need your help, Lord, with this. God, in all of our wrestling and all of our uncertainty, please, will you help us? As we try to fix our own issues, as we try to get out of our boats, get out and do the wave walking in life, we know that you were encouraged that day by Peter's faith to walk on those waves, but you also knew that there was a lesson in wave walking, and that simply is this, that even as we navigate the storms of life and uncertainty, there will always be times that we have to wrestle with our fear. Help us with our fear. Help us with our doubt and our unbelief. and remind us that the storms in our life don't stop because we got out. They stop because you got in. We open our hearts to that truth today. We ask you to help us understand it, believe it, and trust it more. Come on, today, no matter where you are, some of you, God is knocking on the door of your heart in this moment. Jesus, for the first time, is making himself real to you in this moment. He's saying, you don't have to sail the storms of your life by yourself. You don't have to sail these storms alone and drown in the wind and waves of life. No, today it's as simple as this. It's as simple as you letting me onto your boat. The Bible is very clear, friends. All we have to do to begin a relationship with Jesus is open our hearts and let him in. Today, I want to lead you in a prayer. If that's you, no matter where you are, I want to lead you in a conversation between you and God that will give you an opportunity to open your heart to that and discover for yourself what this truth means in your life. Will you pray with me right there where you're at? Come on, we all pray together across these screens, no matter where you are. Pray with me today. Say, Jesus, I need you. I don't want to do this on my own. I don't want an answer to my problems. I want the answer. So today I trust you. I open my heart to you as leader and Lord of my life. Thank you for what you did on the cross for me. You died for my sins. I receive that gift today, and I thank you for it. I won't do everything right, but I will do everything I can to trust you from this day forward. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen.
Well, we are truly so glad to have you with us today. Our heart here at North Rock is to help you take the next step with God. And so we ask, if right now you just prayed that prayer, let us know by clicking the raise a hand link in the chat. Just click on that. Let us know. You can comment to us if you're watching via Facebook, which a lot of people are. We want to know if you prayed that prayer because we want to come beside you, be praying for you, and just find out how we can help you answer any questions that you have, come along with you on your faith journey with Christ. Thank you for doing that. We'd love to know. Now this week, we're going to take the message with us and we're going to grow it in our hearts. And we do that by connecting our weekly Bible plan in the YouVersion Bible app. If you're a friend of North Rock YouVersion, you're going to get an invite every Sunday or Monday morning to this week's plan. It's just going to be laid out for you. You just hit accept and join it. And join in with me and all of our North Rockers as we get a chance to daily read through God's Word together. If you haven't done it yet or you're just getting started, don't worry about that. It's so easy. Don't waste another day. Get in those Bibles with us. And lastly, we need community. We need support in our lives now more than ever. You can find that community right here at North Rock Church in a North Rock small group. Small groups, yeah. We have virtual small groups right now, online, from your couch, in whatever community you're in. They're called mixers. They're private geographical Facebook groups where people can connect online with others where they live. We also have our daily socials that meet at 7 a.m., noon, or 7 p.m. on the Zoom app every single day, Monday through Saturday. And all you have to do is find a group that works for you. And lastly, as always, we are going to be back here, same time, same place next week to worship together. Until then, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May his grace shine upon all of you throughout your week. Guys, God is with you. Don't ever forget it. God loves you. God wants good things for your life. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you soon.